Haq has said that he just aims to write poetry which is neither a nation-building nor an income-generating activity. The special Wasafiri issue on Bangladesh, which is being launched tonight, includes a selection of his poems, as well as an essay by Kaiser on the dialectical relationship between English and Bengali language poetry. One of those poems is A Diaspora Tale, which tells the narrative of Ali Hamza, the Kabadi king of a stretch of boondocks big enough to be an ancient Greek republic, who kills a man, serves his time, then migrates to the US, where he dies obese and still dreaming of return. 10 years and I can go home and die in peace. His ticker wasn't equal to the grease. When I got the news, I thought I'd write a poem. That was years ago. Kaiser's poems often comment, ironically, on the absurdities of colonialism, while also celebrating the rich cultural and social specificities of Bangladesh. Refusing to, quote, head for the diaspora dead end and exhibit an alien multicultural museum, he has a critical relationship to the category of the post-colonial and a commitment to his city. As he writes and published in the streets of Dhaka, here I'll stay, plumb in the center of monsoon-mad Bengal. He has argued that for someone from the third world, leaving one's country means going to the West. And in the West, multiculturalism is a big industry. The negative impact of multiculturalism is most prevalent in America, where non-native writers and artists turn into mouthpieces for American civilization. Being here helps you retain your own country's voice. Please welcome Kaiser Haq.
Thanks to everyone connected with this wonderful festival, and to Sharmila, somewhere there, and Wasafiri for arranging to have me here. You have already got a taste of my poetry from Andrea's introductory remarks. I'd like to start with the poem that, the first poem she mentioned, A Diasporic Tale, which is in the new issue of Wasafiri, which is a special Bangladesh issue. I'm very pleased that Wasafiri has done this issue. It's the first time that a whole issue of a literary journal in Britain has been devoted to Bangladeshi writing. Diasporic Tale. At 65, one turns with alacrity to acts of piety, like recounting the life and death of a childhood hero. Aptly named Ali Hamza, he was the Kabadi king of a stretch of boondocks big enough to be an ancient Greek republic, and sidekick to Dr. Mama, mother's elder brother, a physician 100% true to the Hippocratic oath, and as local body politician, 100% man of the people. Of course, a man of the people, or his sidekick, is never liked 100%. Ali Hamza became a thorn in the side of a big guy in the next village but one. One day, as they were passing each other on a deserted stretch of dirt track, glares gave way to hot words to a push and a shove. Ali's adversary made the mistake of throwing a brickbat at his head. Ali hurled him to the ground, picked up an iron rod rusting away among wayside weeds, and drove it right through his skull. Horrible, no doubt, but imagine the electric wrath, the gorilla grunt, the lightning thrust, and it becomes, from a purely martial angle, a deed worthy of Achilles. He got 12 years for it, a VIP among spiffs, pickpockets, and other low-life convicts, while his son plowed through school, then won a US immigration lottery, pumped gas into SUVs, and in time sponsored his dad's move to the land of the Statue of Liberty. Ali had what we call the yes-no very good variety of English, quickly adding, excuse me, please, sorry, thank you, sir. He got a job as security guard in a motel owned by a Patel, and picked up Hey man, give me five. Stop it right there. That's enough. Fuck off. Addicted to burgers and fries, so yummy and so affordable, he thought, if there's a paradise on earth, it is this, it is this, it is this. 10 years and I can go home and die in peace. His sticker wasn't equal to the grease. When I got the news, I thought I'd write a poem. That was years ago. Another new poem. It's not in the Wasafiri issue, but it will be published in spring next year. A journal called Weber, I think. Weber of the Contemporary West. Santa Haq. No, I've never been to Santa Fe. And I haven't been to Santa Haq either. Two hallowed syllables in common, and a gently curved line 12,000 miles long to link and set them apart. Santa Fe conjures up Wild West reveries on muggy monsoon afternoons. Ghost towns, rattlesnakes, rustlers, barroom brawls, gunfights at sundown, raiders on horseback ambushing a train, the sheriffs glittering tin star, all in cinemascope and technicolor. And Santa Haq, not a name to conjure with. Perhaps my fascination is just a private vice. All I know is that Santa Haq, a small town around the railway junction, its braided steel forged in the furnace of the Raj and stained with the blood of history, is just another place where everyday life goes on. People get off and get on and go off in another direction. Santa Haq, I sigh, yielding to the magic of R, the primal vowel, repeated three times between delicately poised consonants. Why, it's only 50 miles, and I'll need no visa to visit. I must go there one of these days, I say to myself, and lazily Google it on YouTube and find an amateur video. Trees, rough roads, jerry-built offices, schools, homes, hospital, ponds, railway station, bazaar, crowds in movies, just what one would expect, with a sentimental tune playing, and an abrupt end with the scrawled legend, we love it, miss it, and wanna die in it. Unawares, a catch in my throat. Now I know what Sandhara means. It's any place you want to go back to, so you can die in peace. The title poem from my most recent collection, Pariah. Growing up with strays, one learns their ways, making friends with the dust of hostile streets, wary behind the nonchalant gaze, quick to turn the silence of a greeting into warning growls, ready to turn tail, skitter down dark alleys, and bark, 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 as if apocalypse had come. Afternoons, back from Anglophone school, I whipped off my tie and joined the local pack, mid-ranking member of a motley crew. Our leader, just years older, carried neither knife nor knuckle duster. Armed with a wicked sense of humor, he could turn anyone into a laughing stock. We were always in stitches. Neighborhood mothers looked askance. One summer halt, it turned serious for a lark. A tin shack estimating between one tenant and the next became a makeshift mosque. I gave the call to prayer. God is great, great, great. a fusion of raga and rock. He led as imam. The neighborhood rejoiced in the power that lies coiled in disciplined devotion. Halls ended, recipient of a higher secondary certificate. He got a job in his dead father's office. After hours, regaled us with workplace jokes and caricatures. Bored us with plans to acquire higher power. At dead of moonless night in a cemetery, stark naked, he would recite backward from scriptures, and such power would then accrue, he said, whipping out a dirty hanky and letting it swing, that if he wished, he could make earth swing like that. We joined in his laughter, more manic than ever. He was out of his job soon after, his humor of no avail, in fact a liability. Rummaging wanted columns with growing desperation, forgot to laugh, grew morose, glazed eyes refusing recognition to disciple and detractor alike. One day he was ambulanced to hospital bleeding through the throat. He'll be all right now, neighborhood mothers said. He's losing the bad blood that made him sick. But from overheard whispers we knew he had tried to kill himself. Thank God, the whispers said, it was with safety blade, not cutthroat razor. I began missing my prayers. The dog catchers came on their periodic rounds. Caught a local stray and left. I dreamt they were coming to catch me as well. They came back a different being, put up with attempts at a cure with good grace, until doctor utterly out of depth. These are the ways we clean genitals or bottoms. See how culture locks us into intractable difference. You could sum it up in a smart soundbite. East is wash, west is wipe. True, and yet, like all binary oppositions, readily deconstructed, the Chinese are wipers. Their ancient forebears, in fact, invented toilet paper. The French, on the other hand, invented the bidet. One reason why Anglo-Saxons consider them rather peculiar. Ancient Romans used a stick attached to sponge and soaked in brine, something like a modern toilet cleaner. Before toilet paper in the West, rags, straw, leaves, what have you, or as Dryden's Max Legner reminds us, remained in books. And across the Atlantic, the Sears catalogue came in handy for a wipe. Eskimos used snow or tundra grass, Arabs sand and pebbles, and the Maori, Hottentot, Amerindians, and all our other cousins packed tight into this topsy-turvy planet. Scope for serious research here, and interventions for the cause of world peace. Let us break down silly prejudice. A friend got into an argument with a Westerner. How, said one, can you bear to touch your unclean bum with your hand? And how can you, the other came back, leave a layer of shit on yours? Gentlemen, one would feel like interjecting. It's terrible that we don't revere each other's cocks. Let us at least respect each other's bottoms. In the ways we clean up, there's variety to rejoice over, not cavil. And even lessons in philosophy. Check it out if you don't believe me, it's on the net. 60% of Westerners wipe back to front and take a good look at the soiled paper before dropping it in the bowl. Isn't it piquant homage to the Socratic injunction, know thyself? Let us, therefore, give the matter due attention. Let us organize televised toilet festivals, where even ambassadors from every nation will discuss and demonstrate varying means of washing and wiping. Let five-star hotels and holiday resorts offer a sampling of exotic toilets. Igloo toilets dispensing snow and tundra grass. Desert tent toilets with sand and pebbles. Elizabethan toilets equipped with rags. Augustan toilets with first editions of Thomas Chappell. American ones with 19th century Sears catalogues. Roman toilets where guests in togas apply a saline sponge-tipped stick. South Asian toilets where guests in lungi or dhoti pour water out of lota or bodhna as the wash. Already, we can proudly report, the nations have been drawing closer to each other's toilet habits. Every corner shop in Dhaka is well stocked with toilet rolls. And judging by testimony on the net, Westerners seem happy directing a jet of water bottomwards from an innovative nozzle before the wipe. All without encouragement from government or international agencies. A little concerted effort to further the process and we'll have a better world by far. And so let world leaders gathering to talk peace generate mutual goodwill by cleaning each other's bottoms. Should they still grumble and growl, Mahatma Gandhi from high heaven will pipe in. Stop all this hangama. Come and have an enema. Thank you.